I'm Ana Sofia. I'm originally from Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, but I come from Seattle, Washington, where I have been living for 7 years now. I'm a graphic designer and typographer by training, a type designer by passion, and a researcher and printer because I found it so fascinating. Today, I'll be talking about my unique typeface project that I've been working on for a couple of years now. It's a self-directed project. I'm not coming from an institution, just to clarify, because we have a lot of interesting researchers here. So let's jump right into that. Letterpress has been experiencing a resurgence driven by a new generation of printers who are reimagining the field. In Seattle, we have a very active community around the School of Visual Concepts Letterpress courses run by Jenny Wilkson. The school is in the downtown area, just a block from Amazon's headquarters, and close to many other tech companies. So we have a lot of young designers from the tech industry taking courses there and inspiring our longtime Letterpress community. So this is a picture from the shop of the school. And this is a poster that I actually produced there. And you can find here also in the exhibition. So with my own involvement in Letterpress, I'm coming from the typographic perspective. So when I was looking for a type design challenge to tackle, I found an unaddressed problem in the new applications for Letterpress. I realized that although there have been many Letterpress historically inspired digital faces and revivals released in the market, what we are not seeing a proportional effort to develop new type designs functional for both Letterpress and digital uses, especially regarding typefaces for paragraphs. So my project is not a revival, just to clarify, although I love all the revival and historical typefaces. So what I'm seeing in the Letterpress community that got the wheels turning for me and my project starts with a photopolymer technology, which crept into and transformed Letterpress by inviting a new demographic of artists and people interested in the Letterpress aesthetic. Today, Letterpress is used largely to print posters, cards, coasters, covers, broadsides, and let's not forget the fine stationery like invitations and business cards. All these pieces usually require thicker papers as opposed to two-sided documents like book pages, newspapers, and magazines, which used to be long-time traditional applications printed in hot and cold metal type, back until offset and digital printing came along. So this refocus in application was also followed by a change in the desired depth of impression, especially by the upcoming new generation of designers eager for that amazing tactile feel of Letterpress. Even traditional Letterpress world, kiss impression was the best practice that helped preserve and continue to help preserve the precious metal and wood fonts. With polymer plates, this requirement is gone, right? Because we can smash polymer, smash the soft papers, and that's okay. Now let's look at what are the implications of this for typography. On one hand, reproduction technologies have evolved through centuries to translate type into completely flat and very precise surfaces. And today, type designers are not only mainly designing on retina-like high-res screens, but also designing for this type of screens. On the other hand, here's an example of how a digital design can translate in Letterpress. On your left is a digital file, and on your right is the Letterpress print on a Magnani Persia cotton paper. And by the way, the font of the text is Arepo Italic, and it's actually a display face that was intentionally selected and tracked to print well in this piece. What I want to point out is how the original letter forms can be impacted, especially at small sizes. And even if the careful printer avoids any over-inking, in deep impressions, the third dimensional effect creates areas of light and shadow that affect the overall effect of typography. So to reconcile the new Letterpress applications and its typographic fallouts, I suggest, instead of blaming the ink, the paper, or the printer, to offer them better tools, previously tested and intended for those applications. And by tools, I mean typefaces, type designs, right? From a graphic design perspective, it's critical to have typefaces that can be used across different platforms and media to create a consistent visual identity. I'm thinking of branding, right? So this is how I met the rationale and the inspiration to create my first type design. Yeah, working. As a starting point, I set myself to work on a functional contemporary sans serif that can be expressive enough in headings while also useful in small text and caption sizes. Now I will highlight how designing simultaneously for both letterpress and digital purposes led me to this typeface design. For letterpress, I was imagining it would be very useful for short paragraphs and caption sizes like colophons or informational text and stationery, like holiday and business cards. Beyond letterpress, I imagine it being used in branding, packaging, and editorial. I received a hint that it would make also a good candidate for a logo in the aviation industry because of its movement and the airy quality, so I make a kind of mock-up, quick put together here by Airways. Okay, so as an ongoing project, so it's in development. It's actually my first time I'm showing like that in a conference. What I'm sharing here today is my core master for the regular weight and Roman style for a text size. So, and also some tests of a range of weights. Later, I plan to branch an optical size axis and also an axis for impression that I want to also be developing. So this is my core design of Vine. So let's talk about some specific technical features of this design. So it starts with a tall X height to give space for the counters and have more readability at smaller sizes. Semi-condensed proportions to be economic yet elegant because it has a balancing the tall X height. Also, semi-condensed, from my experience, can be very useful and not so common sometimes. Soft modulated strokes that make it a warm, informal, and adds movement while also feeling natural and forgiving of the irregularities of soft papers and impressions. Simple terminals and no serifs that don't require extreme precision to be well reproduced while revealing a contemporary organic slickness of the virtual tool. Open counters and clear joints to help highlight and preserve the essence of the letter form in deep print. Overall, this sets a basic anatomy to be a resilient and flexible in various conditions, with a good range of design space to be further explored. So let's jump. Now I want to share some examples of my letterpress proofing. So far, I have been been printing with photopolymer plates from Boxcar Press. Thank you for existing in the United States. It was second time we mentioned here. On a Vandercook 219 press. And I brought some polymer here, if you guys are curious too. One of the interesting things to notice when I'm looking through a loop, or as we say in Portuguese, conta fio, I don't know if it's the same term, also here in my is how the ink expands more in certain areas rather than others. This, of course, also depends on the side you're feeding your paper. Here's an example of a digital file, again, and it's letterpress print. So on the top, you see, have the digital file, and the bottom is the same file that I was testing. So I will show, I tested in several papers. So let's jump into some round of prints, tests. Here's my first set of proofs for Vine. It was driven by a suggestion coming from Sumner Stone, who was an advisor in this project, to do simulations of real graphic designs to see how my typeface type design would respond. This is a proof. This proof gave me some initial understanding on how the design details were appearing in different scales and directed some core design changes. For example, there were several of these vertical ink traps, like in the F, that felt overdone. And I would say, when I printed and tested, so for the next version, I removed them because they were not actually helping the design. So these, I have all these proofs here with me later if you're curious to have a look at them. So here's a second round of proofs where I started to test some technical aspects like tracking according to weight variation over a range of papers and both rubber and oil inks. So I'm still analyzing the results, but some initial quick observations is there. Actually, there are no much difference between oil and rubber ink effects on the prints. I was very surprised how it worked well for 6 points. It was very legible and in different weights. And I also realized that I need to open more the tracking and continue working on that. So let's jump into this proof, which is my current one. Now, in my current round of proofing for my core design, I'm testing my assumption about digital printing to see how different can be the appearances of the same exact digital font when printed on a high quality laser printer versus a flatbed press using polymer plates. So basically, without adjusting tracking, anything, just the same core design, I've produced this piece. And I brought also to share with you to see how the differences. I have lots of observations, but I have a limited time. So I just want to say that, just to illustrate, the blue areas were printed in digital, and the yellow represent letterpress. It contains parts of the abstract of this conference in different sizes, ranging from 6 to 72. And this proof is helping me to gather information on the best ways to branch from this core design and to develop this depth of impression axis and other variations. I'd love to talk more, as I said, but predicting a short amount of time, I brought copies to share with anyone interested to continue this conversation. So there are over 60 copies. I think it will be for everybody. Thank you very much. Obrigada. I hope you enjoyed, and I'm looking forward to engaging and answering any questions on this ongoing project.